Did you know that you often hold a diffraction grating in your hands? The screen of your mobile phone is one. The pixels form a grid, and you can even measure the distance between them using diffraction. Let us take a phone, a flashlight, and shine a light on the phone screen. We can see that the reflected light from the phone is not just a white spot, but diffraction orders are clearly visible around it.
In this video, I will explain how to find the diffraction orders as easy and quickly as possible, and also discuss how this phenomenon related to Bloch theorem, Fourier transform, and the concept of reciprocal lattice. Before discussing diffraction on a periodic structure, let us first look at what happens when a light passes through a single slit. Let us first recall the Huygens-Fresnel principle. It states that every point on a wavefront is a source of secondary spherical waves, the radiation pattern of which takes the shape of a cardioid, as shown here. However, we will disregard this later and assume that the radiation patterns are just spheres, since we will be considering small angles. According to the Huygens-Fresnel principle, every point in the plane on the slit will emit such a wave. The resulting wave, after passing through such a slit, will be a result of the interference of all the secondary waves. We will think of the wave at the output as a combination of different plane waves with different directions and amplitudes. Let's try to find the amplitude of one of them, propagating at the specific angle theta. To find the amplitude of such a wave, we need simply to sum all the waves coming from the open points of the wavefront. It means simply integrate them by the width of the slit, taking into account the additional phase shift, which is equals kx sine theta. One can easily compute this integral and obtain the simple function of angle theta. If we want to consider several slits, we need to do just the same thing, but integrate by all of them at once. This integral is also easy to solve, and in the expression, the sum appears. If you look closely, this sum forms a geometric progression. By summing the geometric progression, we get an expression similar to the previous case, but with additional multiplier, which is highlighted in red, and also an additional phase factor. Now we have an expression for the amplitude of the field. Knowing the amplitude, we can easily find the expression for the intensity and can plot the graph of the intensity dependence on the sine of the angle theta. For a single slit, it looks like this. Then the second slit is added. The envelope remains the same, but additional minima appear. And in general, as the number of slits increases, the pattern is easy to follow. The diffraction pattern contains main maxima, between which there are n minus 2 additional maxima, where n is the number of slits. Note that the envelope depends only on the width of the slits, but doesn't depend on the number of slits or period of the lattice. Based on the function highlighted in red there, we can find the condition for the main maxima, which is d sine theta equals m multiplied by lambda, where m is integer number. During this time, we have been talking about the intensity of the plane waves emitted in the direction theta. To see any distribution of maxima on the screen, we first need to collect these plane waves at the point, for example, using a lens. Then the diffraction pattern will look like this. Moreover, the condition for the maxima is different for different wavelengths, and that's why we can see the beautiful spectrum here. By now, we have considered diffraction when a plane wave passes through a screen with the slits. But what happens if we consider the diffraction on reflective periodic structure? Will the consideration remain exactly the same? First, we should take the angle of incidence into account. If it differs from 90 degrees, an additional phase shift will appear, which also needs to be considered, but it's easy to do. However, now we don't have a set of slits, but some periodic structure, which can be of arbitrary shape, and in general case, integral may not be solvable. But you can check that if you add any periodic function under the integral, after expanding it into the Fourier series, at least the condition for the maxima remains the same. only the shape of the envelope will change. This condition, with the additional phase shift depending on the angle of incidence, will look as follows. It is simple and easy to remember, but I will show you a way to easily find the directions of diffraction orders even without remembering this formula and not just for a one-dimensional structure. Let's consider some periodic structure with the period d. We draw a sphere with the radius equal to the period of the structure. We draw the incident and transmitted waves whose diffraction orders we are interested in. Then we draw vertical lines through the point where the transmitted wave intersects the sphere, spaced by lambda. Diffraction orders will be in those directions where our vertical lines intersect with the circle. And that's it. You can check that this construction is simply analogous to the condition for the maximum. In simple cases, this construction is the easiest and quickest to use. However, to generalize this task, we now need to multiply everything by 2p over lambda d. Then the radius of the sphere will already be 2p over lambda, which equals k, and the distance between the vertical lines will be 2p over d. The distance between the lines may remind you of something, and indeed, this distance is simply equal to the reciprocal lattice vector. It is not a coincidence, because this construction is the Ewald sphere. Indeed, let's try to move from a one-dimensional structure to a two-dimensional one and see what happens in this case. Now we need to draw not only vertical, but also horizontal lines using the same principle. At the same time, we should always start from this point. Diffraction orders will be only in those directions where our sphere intersects both vertical and horizontal line, for example here. But that was the case of the diffraction on some infinite structure, for example from infinite cylinders. What happens if we now make the cylinders we need and allow our wave vector to lie not only in the plane of the structure, but also go out of it? Then the construction essentially remains the same. Again, we have a reciprocal lattice, and in the two-dimensional case, the order would be in the direction where the atom of the reciprocal lattice intersects with the sphere. But if we allow the k vector to go out of the plane, then we need to draw the entire sphere, not just the circle. The orders will already be in all possible directions where whole lines of the reciprocal lattice intersect with the sphere. What we have here are not atoms, but lines of the reciprocal lattice. And that's fine, because the reciprocal lattice is the Fourier transform of the real lattice. You can check how it will look for different structures. Let us recall Bloch's theorem. It states that in any periodic structure, the field should look like this. An exponent, where k belongs to the first Brillouin zone, multiplied by some periodic function. The periodic function can be expanded into a Fourier series, and in this exponent, the reciprocal lattice vector will appear. We see that Bloch's theorem tells us that all possible reciprocal lattice vectors are added to each wave vector. And the Ewald sphere tells us that the wave can leave the lattice and go into the infinity only if its k vector satisfies the dispersion law of light, omega equals ck. After all, the Ewald sphere just tells us then the dispersion law is satisfied. Therefore, in a medium, there exist waves with all possible k vectors which differ by a reciprocal lattice vector, but only those waves which satisfy the dispersion law can propagate to infinity as plane waves, and those are ones that intersect with the Ewald sphere. We can use this property of periodic structures, for example, to escape from a waveguide. Indeed, suppose a wave is trapped in some planar waveguide and cannot exit. But if we add some periodic perturbation to the waveguide, a reciprocal lattice vector will be added to the wave vector and then some diffraction orders can become radiative. Let's consider a few examples for the case of a one-dimensional grating. Let's assume that our structure is periodic along the x-axis, so along the x-axis the dispersion law of light falls. We'll draw this case both on band structure and on the Ewald sphere. For example, in the case of an incident wave along the x-axis, everything looks like this, and the point moves along the light cone. And in this point, one diffraction order appears. Let's consider normal incidence in our structure. In this case, there is always one diffraction order. And as the frequency increases, two more orders appear. But we can also consider some oblique incidence, and then everything is as follows. Actually, inside each zone on this diagram or on each line, there is always some fixed number of orders, which are easy to find using this method. Now we see that even the consideration of a simple one-dimensional diffraction grating naturally leads to the study of reciprocal lattice. And one can see that Fourier transform also appears everywhere. For example, one can check that the result after the diffraction on a single slit is simply the Fourier transform of the rectangular aperture function. Also, the reciprocal lattice is a Fourier transform of the real lattice, so the Fourier transform just appears here everywhere. Thank you for watching.